We know that there's a lot that's happening as we are in the midst of this Black Lives Matter movement. It comes in a lot of ways. And so we're really happy now to bring on Mr. Tony Lewis, who's going to talk to us about returning citizens and really what we can do in communities like of ours. I mean, we're in Ward 8, as I said, in Southeast D.C. I had a woman ask me, yep, we can hear you, Tony. I had a woman ask me, can you hear me? Tony?
Ms. Bonds, can you hear me?
I can hear you. Yes.
I can hear you.
Okay.
All
right.
Tell
them
to get out and come back.
All right. We want you to go out and come back in and try it again. Just try it one more time. Go back out and come back in, okay? In the meantime, what I would just say is that sadly, and you all can, you know, if you see us online, we'd love to hear your comments about how we're progressing so far or any of the issues that we're talking about. We do have a live comment section, so feel free to just send in your comments. And quickly, I just want to say hi to Terry out there and where she is. I always forget the place, Minnesota. And can you hear me now, Tony?
I can, yes, ma'am.
Fantastic. Yeah, I just wanted to say hi to Terry really quick and Rayvon, who we're going to talk to in a few minutes. But, you know, Tony, the other day I had someone ask me, a white woman, actually, white Jewish woman, who asked me, Denise, what can we do? Hey, brother. Denise, what can we do about the murders in Chicago? And, I mean, I think it's a good question. I think it's an answer that we're all striving for. And I think it's one that you've been on the front lines of trying to get an answer to. So how would you have answered her question, Tony, either there or what we're experiencing right here in Southeast D.C. or in Prince George's County, the rise in gun violence?
Sure. I think, you know, we must have a economic plan to address this sort of culture of violence. We got to draft and we got to eradicate poverty. We got to kill poverty in order to really get people in a place where hope is restored. And if we look specifically in Chicago, where the murders are happening, obviously here in the District of Columbia, definitely specifically when we talk about Black communities, those are communities of poverty. And it's and you know, we have a great infrastructure here in terms of programming. We got the Office of Neighborhood Engagement and Safety. We got Violence Interrupters. And those people are doing their part, you know, but the reality of it is until we can create real systems where people can get to a point of family sustaining employment, where lending can be in a situation where Black people can start thriving businesses and get contracts where they can hire Black people, we really got to really be so committed to doing this. And we haven't. Nowhere in America have we done that enough. And that's why we continue to see all this violence, in my opinion.
Do you think in any way where we are right now with this COVID pandemic, is that contributing? We lost you. Oh, there you are. Do you think that's contributing in any way to the violence that we're seeing right now, or is it not making a difference?
Is what contributing?
The COVID pandemic. Is that contributing in any way?
I would say, yeah, I think everybody's sort of more on edge than they would be under normal circumstances. I think we don't have any idea of the real mental health and the stress and the trauma that COVID is putting on our community, again, particularly Black communities. And so I would like to think that COVID definitely has some relation to the violence that we're seeing. I think what's also, I think, very glaring is that the violence has not decreased in this pandemic. It's actually went up, particularly here in DC. And I think that should tell us something also, that people are that disconnected. People are in lifestyles and have a dependency on being outside for survival that even a pandemic won't keep people inside. So again, I think it speaks back to the necessary focus on Black people in eradicating poverty. Because in DC, right, when it was just us here, if you will, right, and all of the problems were mainly us, it kind of made sense. But in 2020, it's no longer just us, but the problems still remain pretty much us. Mm-hmm. And when I say problems, I'm talking about incarceration, victims of violent crime, unemployment, homelessness, food insecurity, and all the other things you want to name, mental health. So I think it's time for us, I'm talking about particularly the native African-American Washingtonian, that there needs to be a conjoined effort. And we need the business community to be a part of this, right? So it can't just be a social service effort, that collectively, government, private, nonprofit, faith-based, we create a comprehensive strategic plan to eradicate poverty in the Black community here in the District of Columbia. Until we've never seen a safe, poor community in America, and we won't. We want public safety without economic safety. And
well, how does that? I got you. Because I was just getting ready to ask. I mean, how does that? How do you juxtapose that to the call to defund police, and you know, which some think means eradicate or eliminate police? Sure. Where do you stand with that? And how do you think? I understand that there needs to be a balance, but what do you propose?
I think here in D.C., right? I think it's okay to divest a little bit from NPD and put that money towards other public safety strategies that, in my mind, actually helps NPD. We don't have a shortage of police. So, and we've also seen that even with the police force that we have now, these violent incidents still continue to happen. Right. You're not going to lock away this issue, right? You're not going to lock away this problem. We tried that before. We know that doesn't work. We obviously need NPD, but I think we need to invest in other interventions that can help increase public safety. So if that money can be directed into the right entities, if we can get more violence interrupters, if we can get more wraparound services and supports in these communities and other things that provide hope, whether that's training, education, food support, healthier food, all of these things play a role in people's behavior and people's attitudes, right? And people's motivation. So I think we got to really understand that money going somewhere else does not necessarily hurt MPD. I think it also is, in many ways, if we're smart about it, it can actually help MPD.
So we, you know, unfortunately we've run out of time, but I want to get you back on at some point, because one of the other concerns that I have is about education. And so many of these young people now with social distancing, we don't know what's going to happen in public schools, and kids are going to, even if, you know, the age of some of the perpetrators have gotten younger reportedly, and this is an age when they would be involved in some kind of academic sports, whatever kinds of programs to keep them occupied in a positive way. Those are gone now. And we don't know what's going to happen as far as education is concerned. So I do want to get you back on as soon as possible to talk about that as well, and to find out, you know, how we approach that, particularly in the coming months. August, normally school would open, and we just don't know what's going to happen. So I want to thank you so much. I don't know if I lost you already. But thank you for joining us. I hear you, but I don't see you. But thank you, Tony, for being with us and to sharing your thoughts, which I think are critical, because we do need to find solutions because Black lives matter.